Today, let's get right to Guy now with our forecast. Guy, windy day?
Yeah, breezy day ahead. In fact, already feeling like 35. We have a wind chill. 41 is our current air temperature. East-southeast wind, rather, at 9 miles per hour. Again, making it feel like 35. Partly cloudy skies, and that sunrise coming up 7:43.
And some good news, 694 back at normal speeds this morning after a crash here near 50th Street in the northeast corner of the Twin Cities Metro. That was the only crash here I was tracking around the 694-494 loop. So again, ignore that crash icon. No crashes here Metro-wide.
Breaking overnight in St. Paul, take a look at this. A car completely flipped over and charred right there. This happened just hours ago near North High School. You can see several emergency crews on scene. We have reached out to see what happened, and when we find out, you'll be the first to know.
After months of watching, waiting, and wondering, parents across the nation will have their eyes on an FDA meeting this morning.
In just hours, the agency is meeting to discuss Pfizer's COVID vaccine for kids ages 5 to 11. And CC is here with everything you need to know this morning. CC, good morning.
Good morning. The FDA is meeting today to discuss authorization, but this vaccine will only be approved if the CDC gives the okay. When and if that happens, nearly 30 million children ages 5 to 11 could become eligible for the shot. On Friday, Pfizer said its two-dose pediatric shot is more than 90% effective against symptomatic infection. The doses would be administered 3 weeks apart. Keep in mind, the shot is only one-third of an adult dose. According to the American Academy of Pediatrics, COVID cases among children represent about a quarter of all weekly cases reported in the U.S. Health experts say getting kids vaccinated will play a major role in ending the pandemic.
In the era of Delta, children get infected as readily as adults do, and they transmit the infection as readily as the adults do.
The CDC is set to meet November 2nd and 3rd. If approved, shots could be available as early as November 4th or 5th at some locations. Pfizer rep saying the company is ready to ship out doses.
Yeah, big moment indeed. Thanks a lot for that, CC. Another major development for parents, Moderna says half a dose of its COVID vaccine sparks a strong immune response in 6 to 11-year-olds. Early tests showed young kids develop virus-fighting antibodies similar to young adults with a full dose.
Now, as for those 16 and older in Minnesota with one shot, we're sitting at 74.5%. And according to the vaccine dashboard, 58% of those 12 to 15-year-olds in Minnesota have started their vaccine series. MDH numbers yesterday show another day of cases, new cases above 3,000. That is from Thursday, though, and also a backlog. Again, take a look at the two-week moving average. The dotted line here, it is tricking downward, which is how we want it to go. We'll be watching to see if the state is following a national trend of cases declining. Now, another 22 Minnesotans have also lost their lives, and that includes someone in their mid to late 30s and three others in their mid to late 40s. And we're also learning about new travel restrictions less than 2 weeks away. Starting November 8th, anyone coming into the U.S. who is unvaccinated will have to show proof of a negative COVID test. That's from within 1 day of your departure. Those who are vaccinated will also have to have a negative test taken within 3 days of your departure.
Sunrisers, get up and go look at your calendar. Election Day in Minneapolis is 1 week away. Mail-in ballots need to be in the mailbox by today if you want them to be counted. This year, voters are deciding on the city council mayor, rent control, and the future of policing in the city. The city says more people have voted early in person and by mail-in ballot than in any other recent municipal election.
And stay with us for continuing coverage all week on the upcoming elections. We have two voter guides, one for Minneapolis, one for St. Paul. They're filled with information that you'll want to know. You can find them in the featured section of care11.com.
Now here's a look at today's other top stories in your morning rush. The Minnesota Muslim community wants answers after a cemetery was vandalized. The incident happened earlier this month at a building at the Al-Maghfira Cemetery. A gas pipe was cut and a dozen tires were dumped inside. This is the second time the cemetery has been vandalized. A $5,000 reward is being offered for information about what happened. The superintendent at Hmong College Prep Academy is stepping down. Her resignation comes after the state auditor was tipped off about the school finances. More than $4 million were discovered missing in unapproved investments. The report is now in the Ramsey County attorney's hands. Students at the U of M are on high alert for a peeping Tom. Police say a man is sneaking into the co-ed dorms and filming the women while they take a shower with a mint green phone. Officials think the man has been entering the buildings through an emergency exit door that many students use instead of the front door. Dorm staff is asking students to stop doing that. Twin Cities native Libyanka is moving on to the live shows on The Voice. She wowed the panel last night with her rendition of a Billie Eilish song. John Legend called it a masterclass in vocals. LiBianca was up against a fellow Blake Shelton teammate. And that's your Tuesday Morning Rush.
Your time 6:05. New details this morning about the Alec Baldwin shooting investigation and the death of Helena Hutchins on the set of the movie Rust last week. There are some new concerns about the film's assistant director when it comes to weapon safety on set. According to newly released affidavits, Baldwin was handed the weapon from a cart by assistant director Dave Halls, who didn't know there were live rounds in the gun.
An AD should never be touching a gun. They can ask for a safety inspection. They can ask questions, but they should never, no crew member other than the armor or the talent should be touching a weapon ever.
Halls was the subject of two different safety and behavior complaints during two different 2019 productions. A production company from a previous movie says he was fired after a gun incident on set there. Halls hasn't responded to requests for comment. Meanwhile, Baldwin tweeted in part, "There are no words to convey my shock and sadness regarding the tragic accident that took the life of Helena Hutchins, a wife, mother, and deeply admired colleague of ours." He went on to say that he's offering support to Helena's husband and son at this time. And Baldwin's wife, Hilaria, speaking out for the first time in this Instagram post, writing, "My heart is with Helena, her husband, her son, their family, and loved ones. It said there are no words because it's impossible to express the shock and heartache of such a tragic accident." Production on the film Rust is shut down indefinitely as an investigation continues on. But yeah, a lot of people still, you know, wondering how this even happens in this day and age on a movie set.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people wondering, you know, with so many checks in place, now that we've learned so much more about this too, and other people speaking out about what it's like to be on set, with so many checks in place, how did this happen? It could have been
all through the cracks.
Yeah.
This morning, hospitals nationwide are trying to keep up with a spike in serious COVID cases. One problem, a lot of people are going to the emergency room and they don't really need to. Tim Furlong shows you how to spot a cold or COVID in your child.
So we saw no cases of flu the entire year last year.
Last year, the Nemours Children's Hospital in Delaware saw no flu and barely any of the more normal common colds. But now?
But now that it's back, it's spreading pretty rapidly.
Nemours Emergency Department had over 20,000 visits, about 250 per day between August and September. This is far above the average number of patients who came in during the height of the pandemic. It's really increasing wait times, and many of those moms and dads probably did not need to bring their kids here first.
With kids separated and masked up for so long, many of the colds and viruses we normally see, they weren't floating around as much. That was a good thing. But now that everybody's back together, colds and viruses are making a comeback, and understandably, many of us parents look at a cold symptom and go, is it cold or is it COVID?
Let's be clear. If your child is struggling to breathe or is very dehydrated, get them to the ER at your local hospital right away. But for most symptoms,
fevers, coughs, sore throats, runny noses.
Yeah, for those, you should call your pediatrician for guidance first. Maybe they'll bring you in, maybe they'll send you to an urgent care center, or maybe they'll tell you how to treat things at home. And if your child has some of those less dangerous symptoms and you just need to get a COVID test, Nemours says don't go to the ER.
That's really all you need to know is this COVID and can I go back to school? It's better to do that in one of the community testing centers.
Look, I know it can be confusing and a little bit scary, but we need to keep the ERs ready for the people, or in this case, the children who need them most. Tim Furlong, NBC News, Wilmington, Delaware.
Well, happening right now, the first of two nor'easters is raining down on the East Coast. Here's a live look from New York. You can see this windshield wiper right there going off. A lot of rain out there. About 30 million people from New Jersey to Maine are under flash flood watches. Some places could see up to 5 inches of rain.
Yeah, that biker wasn't deterred, though. Let's get to Guy right now. Are there one thing weather?
Yeah, a little breezy today. High-level clouds that are on this afternoon. High temperature of 56.
And watch for lane restrictions on Highway 10 westbound between Coon Rapids and Anoka this morning, kicking off tonight at 8, wrapping up tomorrow at 5 a.m.
Well, since the start of the pandemic, face masks have become part of everyday life, and they're ending up in our landfills.
But can the disposable mask be recycled? Our Verify team looked into it.
Can disposable face masks be placed in everyday recycling bins? Our sources are the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, the United States Environmental Protection Agency, the Marine Conservation Group Oceans Asia,
Tom Zaki, the Chief Executive Officer of the global recycling company TerraCycle,
and David Biederman, CEO of Solid Waste Association of North America. According to the Oceans Asia report, disposable masks can take close to 450 years to fully break down. Since there are several types of disposable face masks on the market, we're going to focus on the disposable medical face masks. In a press release from March 2020, the EPA said masks should not be tossed into recycling bins, and NOAA agrees.
Like any other type of trash, they need to be put in a secure trash can so they can be disposed of properly.
However, these masks can actually be recycled. In the U.S., there are several recycling companies that, for a fee, will drop off a box and will pick it up once the box is full of disposable face masks. CEO of TerraCycle, a company that turns hard recycled items into raw materials, explains.
We first shred them so we can separate them into the three basic material types that they're made from. You have non-woven plastics, you have metals, which is, again, usually the nose thing, and then elastomers, which is the band and the stretchy part that goes around the face.
Zaki explained the raw materials are not used to make new face masks. For example, the rubber strings that go around your ears.
Those are ground and then can be used in flooring applications or different, typically surface applications.
But David Biederman of Solid Waste Association of North America says these masks should stay out of traditional recycling bins.
They're not recyclable in curbside unless the local government has set up the special system that you need to recycle that material.
So we can verify, no. Disposable face masks cannot be placed in everyday recycling bins. With your Verify, I'm Ariane Till.
Sunrise was a huge day for professional soccer on deck today right here in the Twin Cities.
The U.S. women's national team is in town for a match, but this isn't your average game. Jennifer is live at Allianz with a preview.
Yeah, that's right, Chris and Gia. So the team is playing South Korea tonight, but that is not the highlight of the game. A U.S. soccer star is playing for the final time tonight with the U.S. women's national team, and it's all happening here in St. Paul. We'll have more on that coming up, Chris and Gia.
Working from home could save you big on gas, clothes, even food. But what's it costing you for not being in the office? In 10 minutes, the cost of COVID behind the medical bills.
Plus, taking breakfast to court, you gotta hear why one woman is suing over Pop-Tarts.
Eat an egg.